Why this move towards banking suddenly in the last 2 years? Because you have some technical expertise, why not utilizing those technical expertise?
Sir, because when I was in college only, well, in the college I realized that I wasn't really interested in engineering. In 10th standard, we don't usually have much choices. It's usually commerce or engineering only. So I chose engineering because I was better in science and math. But in engineering, I realized that I wasn't interested in that. And I had some knowledge. I used to read newspaper from that time only. So I had some knowledge about political and economics and all. So I realized that I was more inclined towards economics portion. So that's why I decided to pursue the training.
Okay, and why RBI specifically?
So it's because in the last 2 years I have read a lot, and I realized that if I had to go for economics background, I have been studying since the past 2 years only, and I realized that now I need something like a real life experience rather than going for masters or doing some other studies. So that's why when I researched the options, what were the best. And so RBI is the central bank, and the opportunities that it presents, I don't think that we can really find anywhere else in India. So that's why I decided to choose RBI.
But let's say you get into RBI.
Yes, sir.
Certainly, you will have to pursue your master's and other further studies to ensure that you stay afloat and understand the entire banking and
Yes,
economic system in the long
sir.
run. But you mentioned that you're not interested in pursuing your studies further.
I am not at this moment. Actually, since the last 6 years, I have been studying only first engineering, and then for the last 2 years, I was preparing for UPSC. So that's why I didn't have much job experience also. So right now, I wanted to experience that first, and I'll later, if I have to do master's, so I'll continue it later.
So let's say tomorrow you get into RBI, we take you in,
Yes.
and then you also get into UPSC. So would you want to move to UPSC?
Sir, right now I believe that I'm not that much. After studying for UPSC, I've realized that out of the whole package, it's the economics portion that I like the most. So I believe that I'll achieve a lot in RBI because it's in that specific direction. So I'll like to continue here
But
only.
let's say you get into IRS and RBI, what will you do?
Sir, I was not really interested in IRS from the beginning only. It was UPSC was the option because I wanted to do something on the social side, and I believe that IAS is the one that connects us directly with the people, not the IRS directly. So I wasn't really interested in IRS, so I don't believe that I'll shift to
Okay.
IRS.
You mentioned that you've been reading the newspaper for the past 2 3 years. You're interested in news related to
Yes.
economics. So can you specifically and briefly tell me what are the major reasons for the current economic slowdown in India?
So I believe that this is not, it's not a one instant thing. It has been brewing since a lot many years, like starting with, I believe, with the demonetization. Demonetization sucked out liquidity from the people, mostly in who are in the lower background, whose daily earnings got affected a lot. And that's why it continued. And after that, we had another reform as GST. GST was a well-intentioned reform, but I didn't think it was implemented in a very efficient manner. So, and after that, along with that, NPA level crisis also increased, and banks also couldn't lend a lot. Then moving on, NBFC crisis erupted. So all these things leading together, right now people have the money, but demand is not there. Especially in the rural areas, people don't have a lot of money to spend either. So demand is really down. And this has been continuing since last 3 4 years, starting with demonetization. The jobs have decreased and people don't have money in their hands. So I think it's the whole.
Have the structural problems in Indian economy also started with demonetization?
Sir, I don't believe it's the root of everything. I think the it got the
What
problem
do you
which are
mean by
all.
structural problems in the
So
economy?
structural reforms are major reforms which don't impact overnight. They have been continuing for the long time.
Give me an example.
So like bank crisis, NP crisis only. Mm-hmm. It has been its root lies in 2000 starting years only.
No, you're giving me long, very twisting answers. What I'm asking is some examples of what are the structural reforms that we need.
So like labor laws, we need different code. They have started right now. Ki we'll implement. Restructure all the labor laws into four codes, but that has been done for a long time. Labor laws are not there and employment opportunities are not there in the country. So these are the main issues why our economy is not up to that level.
So do you know that US Federal Reserve targets the employment rate as part of its monetary policy transmission process?
Sorry, ma'am, I didn't know that.
Okay, the US does. For example, in India, we target the CPI,
yes,
Consumer
ma'am.
Price Inflation Index. The US Fed targets the employment rate as well.
Okay.
So do you think RBI should also start targeting the employment rate because you say that employment is down?
Ma'am, I don't think that RBI is the correct agency to do that. I believe that government should focus a lot more on employment issues. RBI's main function should be monetary policy and transmission of that only. It's the government, right now it's the government job to create more employments because that has been their manifesto also for a long time. And no matter which the government is in the center, it's the employment is always important for the country like India, where there are population is very high and there are lot many people who have enough skills but they don't have the right jobs. So it's, I think the government has a more responsibility in this direction.
But RBI also has a responsibility to maintain yield stability,
yes, ma'am,
as it is part of RBI's preamble. So employment is a part of growth stability.
Yes, ma'am. That's true. So it's, I believe that it's everyone, if everyone works in a unison, then the final result can be a lot better if we are working in silos. So everyone should work together.
So you believe that RBI should stick to its domain?
Not exactly stick to its domain. It's like the main responsibility should be of the government and RBI should do whatever it can to speed up the process, we can say. But I believe that it should be the government's main responsibility to improve the employment scenario in the country.
Okay. So Rashmin, you've been a champion at state level in RBS.
Yes, ma'am.
Are you still in touch with it?
No, ma'am. I usually did that in my school time. And there are 10 levels which you have to achieve and I completed all those levels. So it was kind of like
a... But are you a good mathematician?
I believe so, ma'am.
What is 32 square?
1024.
So, economics is your interest.
Yes, ma'am.
But is RBI only about economics?
Ma'am, RBI is not only about economics. RBI does a lot of functions. First of all, RBI is the central bank of the country, so it handles the main monetary policy of the country, and it also supervises and regulates the banks and NBFCs in our country. It provides the funding when it maintains the liquidity in the economy, and so that
is part of monetary policy.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, but go ahead.
And the main function of RBI includes the issuing of currency notes and keeping the inflation in check. So it has a long range of functions.
Yes. Some important functions are also ensuring that financial inclusion.
Yes,
financial
ma'am.
Inclusion is a very important function of RBI.
Yes, ma'am.
Financial markets regulation is a very important function of RBI that is somewhat separate from monetary
banks
policy. Regulation of government bond markets is a very important function of RBI. Being a debt manager to the government of India is a very important function of RBI.
In fact,
RBI is a banker to the government of India and to the government of state governments,
yes,
by
ma'am.
Agreement.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So can you tell me a little bit about gig economy?
Ma'am, gig economy is mostly when the jobs that are prevalent in the economy are most of the contractual basis and not of on the permanent lines that we used to see some 20 to 30 years back. Today, most of the jobs we see are like contractual basis, like a man is hired only for a short period of time and after that, when the job's over, you have to find another job. And And with the changing in scenarios, with the changing world economy, that's not a wrong thing either, because the jobs are not, the population is very large and the equal number of jobs are not there. So people tend to choose a job that implement their skill level rather than sticking in a temporary permanent job which doesn't give them that satisfaction which a temporary job can give.
Yeah. Actually, the reason is the other way around. The reason why the gig economy is going to be the future of the country is that India is increasingly becoming a part of global value chain. And being a part of global value chain means the changes that are occurring in manufacturing processes across the world will quickly transmit to India.
Okay.
And as in how the manufacturing changes transmit to India, or for that matter, even in the services sector, you need to keep churning the kind of people that you need to be employed by you.
Okay.
You will always find the people with the required skill set, but perhaps employing them on a permanent basis may not be a very good idea.
Okay.
So, So the informal sector has always been in India.
Yes, ma'am.
It's that now we're calling it the gig economy.
Because mostly informal sector were in like construction and all those jobs which were on the low level. But right now, even in the services and high level jobs also, contractual jobs are being flourishing. So
yeah,
that's why it's, I think it's known as gig economy.
Yeah, so not low level, call it the blue collar economy.
Okay.
And the high level would be the white collar economy.
Okay.
That's a better way of saying it.
Okay.
Where do you see yourself 20 years down the line?
Ma'am, if I'm in RBI, I want to see myself as a person who can have some direct impact in the journals. I want to be in touch with the people and I want to make a difference. Even when I'm in RBI, I think that I will be more connected to the people, and if I want to do something that I have believed, like in social work also, I can pursue that along with that, and I'll do the both the things that I like.
Then you should go for the IAS, ma'am.
Ma'am, IAS, if we want to make impact, I believe that in IAS it's the basic, in the starting years that you are in contact with people only for a small amount of time, and then after that, that contact links breaks eventually, and it's not, you're not in contact with people for a really long time. So I believe that's not the, this thing I found out eventually when I started studying only. Before that I didn't know what exactly the job entails, because no one really knows what's going to happen when you are in that position. But that contact with being in the people is only for when you are in the district. After that, when you work in the secretariat, the link between the people break. And I don't want to look at that.
So you have mentioned in your biodata that you have a little bit knowledge about lawn tennis.
Yes, sir.
So who is the person who has won the maximum number of Grand Slams?
Sir,
and how much?
Male, it's Roger Federer, 20 Grand Slams, and in female, it's Serena Williams.
Okay. RBI has been using a lot of quantitative as well as qualitative instruments in order to control money supply.
Yes, sir.
Can you briefly describe some of the qualitative instruments and how are they used?
So qualitative instruments are those which do not directly impact the money supply in the market, like moral suasion, where they nudge the bank to do the right thing, like lend to the right sectors or do not change the interest rates according to the market scenarios. And market suasion is there. Then margin to loan value ratio. And if these easy steps don't work, they can also take harsh steps like penalties to the bank, so that the whatever RBI expects of them, the banks are heading in the right direction.
What about margin requirement?
So margin requirement is, it's slipping out of my head. Margin requirement is like when you are giving a loan, I believe the margin that you that the people have to pay for themselves.
Can you explain margin requirement using one of the examples?
Sir, like example, if I want to take a car loan for 8 lakhs and the car is around 10 lakhs, so margin will be the 2 lakhs that I have to put for the car myself and 8 lakhs loan I can take.
Okay. Is Colindrol involved in this?
So, I believe so.
Can you tell me something about green shoe option and how it is used for in the stock market?
So, whenever a company is issuing an IPO, then there is a possibility that it will be purchased 100%, or there is also a possibility that it won't be purchased. It will be purchased for less amount. But when there is a possibility that it's purchased 100%, then they keep, in the green shoe option, they keep a 15% shares aside extra so that they can change the stock prices of, they can change their stock prices for some time. And they can buy, they can sell the, sell in the market, and they can change the price accordingly.
If the shares are fully subscribed, then why is green shoe option required? Why this leverage of 15% or surplus of 15% of shares is required?
So, I believe when it's less subscribed, then they can purchase the shares, and that will increase the stock prices, the stock underlying prices, and it will, the stock can become more attractive in the market and more people will subscribe to it.
What is the purpose of shoe option?
It's mainly to, I think, attract the buyers to and increase the price rate.
What is the difference between repo rate and bank rate, and which of these is higher and why?
Repo rate is, both the rates are done by RBI. Repo rate is for the short term loan and bank rate is for the long term. And repo rate is when the RBI lends loans to bank for a short term while, for mean you can say 15 days or so, and bank rate is a long term rate, and bank rate will be higher because in long term there is more possibility of fluctuation, so longer rates bonds are always at higher value than the short term bonds.
You have read about the PNB fraud. There was a document involved in PNB fraud, which was the major cause of the fraud that occurred. What was the document involved?
LOU, letter of understanding.
Okay, what is the difference between letter of undertaking and letter of credit?
Letter of undertaking is like when a bank take loan, when a person take loans in a foreign market, so the person's bank, person's account in the native country reassures the bank that if the person will commit a fraud, then the bank, the person's bank in the native country will pay back the loan to them. So that's assurance is known as letter of undertaking. And letter of credit, I don't really remember.
Have you heard about the term willful defaulter?
Yes, ma'am.
What is it? Who is willful defaulter?
Ma'am, a willful defaulter is a person who has the ability to pay back but doesn't decide, but decides not to pay back to the bank. Like recently only we saw the case of Nirav Modi, who had the required amount or the like collateral or things he had, but he decided not to pay back and instead commit a fraud.
Rashwin, we are taking the margin as well and the collateral as well when we are lending to someone.
Yes, ma'am.
Then why is the status of NPAs still increasing?
Ma'am, we usually take a collateral, but I believe that the value of the collateral is not in accordance with the loan that the banks are providing. And also we have seen that many times the person who is lending inside the bank also is a partner in the, is also the one who is involved sometimes. So like in PNB fraud also we seen, and in culture fraud also we saw that they lent to one party only and there were some mismatches also. So that's one part of it, and the another part is that collaterals are not up to the mark, and the willful defaulters case is very high also, because we have seen in insolvency and bankruptcy board also there are many parties where the people have the potential but they don't pay back. So when we combine all these things together, the NPA crisis is very high. And also we have seen that most of the loans that were lent were for a long term time and for the infrastructure sector, but because of many problems in our infrastructure industry right now, that loan, the project gets delayed due to many reasons. So that's why also those infrastructure loses their potential, and loans they, which they have taken.
Can you give me an example for this situation? I have the collateral. I can go into the market and sell it. I can recover my loan. Then why still? If we take the PNB for itself, okay. Then we can talk about it. We can just take the collateral, go into the market and sell the property and get our loan recovered.
Ma'am, maybe the potential, there are not many potential buyers for that property because the market value may have increased, or the value of the project is not that much as they were expecting to get the return. So that's why I believe that they are not able to get their required value.
What is the current status of NPA in terms of the public banks and the private banks?
Ma'am, I don't remember the exact values. Totally, it's around 9.3%, and I think it's around 11 to 12% for public sector banks and around 2 to 3% for private sector banks.
And why is it so that private sector banks have less NPA status and public sector banks have higher NPA status?
Ma'am, the main reason for this is that public sector banks are mostly for public welfare, and they are the ones that have lent to the infrastructure sector for a really long time. Private sectors don't invest that much in long-term infrastructure opportunities, and public sector have to invest because they are mainly for this. They were focused on that they have to lend to these purposes because we don't have a strong bond market. So infrastructure sectors didn't also have many opportunities to get the loan. And these projects, because they got delayed, so the higher number of frauds were linked with public sector banks. And also I believe the administrative side also is a little better in private sector banks compared to public sector banks. So these both conditions together.
What can be done to improve this?
Ma'am, like we saw in a PNB case that there was an issue of SWIFT, and after the fraud happened, they decided to improve on that condition and they made it better so that this purpose can't be again used in a fraud in later scenarios. So like this, we should we always have a, like, after the issue happens then we correct the things, and it would be beneficial if we can remove the bottlenecks beforehand only rather than after a fraud has been committed.
Of late, we have been hearing that RBI is considering
2019-20
as an exceptional year. Why is it so?
Ma'am, because after a really long time, the growth rate of India has fallen into 4 to 5. They are expecting that real growth rate of India will be around 5% and nominal growth rate will be around 8%. And it has been almost after a decade that nominal growth rate has fallen below a double digit level. And that's why it's being considered an exceptional year.
Is this the only reason?
No, I don't know anything else.
Okay. The government is facing high fiscal deficit this year, despite transfer of that 1.76 lakh crore by RBI. Why is it so?
Ma'am, because the revenues are very less in the government side, because fiscal deficit is, we can say, the difference between the revenue and expenditure. And the revenue side is very less. The GST returns are also very less, and the government has decided to reduce the corporate tax to 22%. And the corporate tax has been one of the highest earners of revenue for the government, and reducing corporate tax will be a major hit for the government. And because the GDP is low, so fiscal deficit is also always in comparison to the GDP. So even if the GDP decreases and the fiscal deficit is not very high, even then the ratio will become very high and we'll have high fiscal deficit this year.
Okay. GDP is decreasing, how fiscal deficit is going to decrease in terms of
percentage? Not fiscal, in percentage, ma'am, because if we say that the government decided to have a fiscal deficit, say, of 1.44 lakh crore on a GDP of 10 lakh crore, but because the GDP has decreased, so the percentage will decrease because of the denominator effect.
Why such a high fiscal deficit is such a big issue in our country? Why are you always chasing an ideal fiscal deficit target?
Ma'am, fiscal deficit is important because I believe in the global scenario, this is the one thing that they judge a government by, like how much a country is placed in what level is decided by its fiscal deficit is one important factor of it. And the government, because we have that committee also which has said that we should decrease the fiscal deficit to 3.33% by 2020-2021, and the government has been trying to follow the advice of the committee. So that's why also government is trying to keep a fiscal deficit in a level check.
Okay. Depreciation or devaluation, which of the two is done by RBI?
Ma'am, devaluation.
How is it done?
Ma'am.
And when it is done?
Devaluation of the currency. Just a second. Ma'am,
okay, no problem. Do you think India is facing a phase of stagflation right now?
Ma'am, we can say that there is stagnation because the GDP growth is decreasing, but inflation before the last month, inflation has been below the 4% level target only, and it was only in the last 2 months that inflation has risen beyond the 4%, and it's mostly because of the food inflation, because this year the rainfall were also very erratic, and that's why the food prices have risen, and also in global environment also the crude prices have been rising. So that's why the food and fuel, because of the increase in food and fuel prices, inflation is rising. So it's not, I believe that this inflation will not stay for a very long time. So I can't say that India is right now in a stagflation.
Okay, if it is so, if it is in a phase of stagflation, how it can be tackled?
Ma'am, stagnation and inflation, when both are there in the economy, so stagnation can only be improved when there is more money supply in the economy. So because we have to increase the growth, and growth will be increased when people have more money and they can lend more and there are more investments. But stagnation, when we increase the growth rate, there is also the growth inflation, both go in hand.
You are explaining me what is stagflation. I am asking you how to solve stagflation. If there is, the situation is there, how can we tackle it then? I know if we are going to increase the money supply, inflation will increase. That is stagflation. How we are going to tackle it? Is there any way out?
Ma'am, I believe that first we have to improve the growth only, and later the inflation can be kept in check. Because if the growth is not there, then the economy will keep on sliding down, and more the economy slides down, more the inflation will increase. So it's kind of a vicious cycle, I believe.
Have you heard of the term reserve transposition with IMF?
Yes, ma'am.
What is it?
Ma'am, that is a person that the economy keeps with IMF, so that whenever they are in a dire need, they kept. I believe that reserve trans is kept in your own currency only, so that whenever you are in a dire need for some money, you can take the money out of that, and you can complete it back after when your need is over.